Welcome to St. John's Lutheran Church, Springfield, Ohio. Today is the 4th of March, 2018.
Thank you. Grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Thank you. message about the cross is foolishness to those who are perishing, but to us who are being saved, it is the power of God. For it is written, I will destroy the wisdom of the wise, and the discernment of the discerning I will thwart. Where is the one who is wise? Where is the scribe? Where is the debater of this age? Has not God made foolish the wisdom of the world? For since, in the wisdom of God, the world did not know God through wisdom, God decided, through the foolishness of our proclamation, to save those who believe. For Jews demand signs, and Greeks desire wisdom. But we proclaim Christ crucified, a stumbling block to Jews and foolishness to Gentiles. But to those who are called, both Jews and Greeks, Christ, the power of God and the wisdom of God. For God's foolishness is wiser than human wisdom, and God's weakness is stronger than human strength. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Pollock is preparing to read the gospel. He is in the ascended pulpit, and people are standing, showing their great respect for the gospel that Pastor Pollock is getting ready to read.
The Holy Gospel according to St. John, the second chapter. Glory to you, O Lord. The Passover of the Jews was near, and Jesus went up to Jerusalem. In the temple, he found people selling cattle, sheep, and doves, and the money changers seated at their tables. Making a whip of cords, he drove all of them out of the temple, both the sheep and the cattle. He also poured out the coins of the money changers and overturned their tables. He told those who were selling the doves, take these things out of here. Stop making my father's house a marketplace. His disciples remembered that it was written, zeal for your house will consume it. The Jews then said to him, what sign can you show us for doing this? Jesus answered them, destroy this temple, and in 3 days I will raise it up. The Jews said, this temple has been under construction for 46 years, and will you raise it up in 3 days? But he was speaking of the temple of his body. After he was raised from the dead, his disciples remembered that he had said this, and they believed the scripture and the word that Jesus had spoken. The gospel of our Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
You may be seated. A couple of announcements to share with you. First of all, a reminder of our midweek Lent services at 2 and 7 p.m. this week. We will examine Pilate's worried wife with the cross head, kind of effect the cross head on Pilate's worried wife. Also, remember next Saturday night, before you go to bed, turn your clock up an hour, because if you don't, this time next week, it will be 10 of 12, not 10 to 11, so you'll be late. So remember, spring ahead, lose that hour of sleep, unfortunately. So please remember to do that next Sunday. Also, at request of some, you will find on page 11 in your bulletin, a page for sermon notes. So those of you who like to take notes in the sermon, actually have paper to write on. I'm not putting questions on anymore, just leaving it for you to take your own notes. And the last announcement, I ask for your prayers and acts of sympathy for our brother Josh Gibson on the passing of his grandfather, Ben Gibson, from the Church Militant to the Church Triumphant. Viewing will be Tuesday evening at Littleton and Rue, and the funeral will be at 10:30 Wednesday morning. So please remember Josh and his family in your prayers. As now that you give your attention, our Lord.
Thank you.
Christ. Amen. I have been told that one of the benefits of retirement is that you no longer have to listen to your alarm clock, nor is your life governed by your date book. That once retired, you can sleep as long as you want, and you can do whatever you want to do for as long as you want without the fear of missing an appointment. I remember Pastor Ray Garrett telling me that the most liberating day of his life was the day he retired and he had to take the little red date book that we pastors used to receive from the publishing house and toss it in the garbage can and realize he didn't have to go by it every day anymore. And he told me how one day he was sitting in his backyard reading a book, and he'd been reading for a while, and he thought, I better go inside. I'm sure got me somewhere. And then he realized, I'm retired. I can continue to read for another 2 hours if I want. Well, that's what I hear. Lent comes along and is our spiritual alarm clock, waking us from our sleepiness in spiritual slumber that we might have fallen into after the celebration of Christmas. Especially if the Sundays after Epiphany go as far as the 8th Sunday after Epiphany. That means Ash Wednesday's not until March sometime, and with it being winter, that green time makes it easy for people to retire from church attendance. But Lent comes along and reminds us that we need to be spiritually awake. And as we celebrate the season of Lent, there are three words that we constantly hear: repentance, remembrance, and renewal. Now, repentance is easy. We all know what repentance is. Most Sundays we begin our worship, the order of confession and forgiveness. We confess our sins, we hear the words of absolution, assuring us that we are forgiven and have the promise of eternal life. Remembrance, we're quite familiar with that. Lenten season reminds us of the passion of our Lord Jesus Christ. All the suffering that he went through so that he could pay our debt of sin so that we might be his own and live under him in his kingdom. But what is renewal? To what are we renewing? Or you could substitute the word recommitment. To what are we recommitting? In order to discover that, we turn to our gospel lesson today. And we discover that what we are committing to are the priorities of Jesus. And that these priorities of Jesus should be part of our daily life. And focusing on those priorities of Jesus will keep us from falling into a spiritual slumber. Will prevent us from falling into a sleepiness concerning our attending worship of our Lord Jesus Christ. So we go back to our gospel lesson today, and we begin with that 13th verse of the second chapter of the Gospel of John, where we read, the Passover of the Jews was at hand, and Jesus went up to Jerusalem. Your first priority. The first priority of Jesus, as we read from our gospel lesson today, was a priority of the importance of routine faithfulness. Routine faithfulness to our Lord Jesus Christ. For Jesus, it was routine faithfulness to God the Father. Faithful to him and to worship him. When God made the covenant with the Hebrew children, Moses at Mount Sinai, one of the commands he gave them was that they would celebrate the Passover. And the Passover was a very important festival in Jewish life, and every devout Jew would celebrate. And many would try to make it to Jerusalem for the celebration. So we read Jesus going up to Jerusalem because it was his routine. It was his priority that he be faithful to his Jewish traditions, that he be faithful to his Jewish religion. No devout Jew would ever dream of ignoring the celebration of Passover. And even Jews who are less event. Some of our Reformed Jewish friends here in America that don't have a real good habit of going to synagogue every Friday will at least gather their family together to celebrate Passover. As Christians, we are to be faithful to God's will and to God's commands. As you heard in our first lesson for today from the book of Exodus, God giving Moses the Ten Commandments. The third commandment, remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. The word remember is very important. It is the Hebrew word zakar. And the word literally means to impress something on one's mind. To impress it so that they won't forget it. That there is no way they can forget that. It means to mark something so that you can recognize it. As Christians, we are marked with the cross of Christ forever in our baptism to show that we are God's children through our faith in Jesus Christ. If you are a rancher, you brand your cattle, your sheep, and your horses so that if they get stolen or if they get intermingled with somebody else's herd, you can pick yours out. So Jesus, our God, is saying through this commandment that the Sabbath is so important that we need to mark it in our minds. So it's always recognized it's important. It means to pierce. Here the word is like piercing, taking it off, piercing through a piece of leather. Or piercing the earlobe in order to put in an earring. So God is saying, pierce your mind, impress upon your mind, mark your mind so as to remember to take that day to worship me. Of course, as Christians, we took the Sabbath and transferred it to Sunday because that is the day of our Lord's resurrection. And it became the tradition in the early church, the apostolic church, that Christians celebrated on Sunday. It wasn't something that came along much later. It was something from a very early church. It is important to take time out for God and our Lord Jesus Christ. This is why, in your small catechism, Luther's explanation to the third commandment, he writes, we should so fear, love, and trust God that we do not despise his word or the preaching of it, but gladly hear and learn it. So the emphasis on a priority of worship, the same priority Jesus had. Jesus went to the synagogue every Sabbath. He went to the temple when he was in Jerusalem for every festival. He went to the temple when he was in Jerusalem, even during the week. And so we follow his example of so fear, love, and trust in God that we do not despise his word or the preaching of it, but gladly hear and learn it. This is what was so troubling when I was in seminary and I had classmates who were talking about not even doing a sermon on Sunday, just going to have communion every Sunday and that would take care of things. Faith comes from the hearing of God's word, St. Paul tells us. Faith comes from hearing and hearing from the word of God. Without God's word being preached, there is no faith. Because the Holy Spirit works through the word of God. Without the word, he has nothing to work through. And so we are to make the priority of routine faith. To make it a priority to that routine faithfulness of being in the house of our Lord Jesus Christ and worshiping him and giving thanks to God for him. We gather as a community of faith, brothers and sisters in Jesus Christ. So in that sense, we're a communal faith. But when it comes to salvation, it is an individual faith. You cannot go to church for somebody else. And I know when I was first out of seminary, I sometimes would hear this from members of the congregation. Well, my wife goes to church for both of us. Or grandma goes to church for all of us. Sorry, but it doesn't work that way. When it comes to salvation, you have to believe. You have to confess. You have to affirm your faith. It's like the old story about John and Mary. Mary would go to church every Sunday. John would not go to church, maybe Christmas and Easter or lucky. Somebody asked him one day about if he went to church. A new friend he had, he said, no, Mary goes for both of us. So that night, old John had a dream. And in that dream, he and Mary died. And he and Mary appeared before the gates of heaven. And St. Peter met him, and he said, come in, Mary, welcome to the place prepared for you for our Lord Jesus Christ, and closed the gate. And old John said, hey, St. Peter, what about me? St. Peter turned and replied to him, Mary is going to heaven for both of you. See, we have to have salvation ourselves. We can't rely on anyone else. And so Jesus' priority was to have that routine faithfulness, always being faithful to the word and to worship, to the festivals and traditions of Judaism, and we should show such faithfulness to the word and to the celebrations of the church. The second priority of Jesus that we learn from our gospel today is the necessity of setting God's house in order. Verse 14, in the temple he found those who were selling oxen and sheep and pigeons and the money changers sitting there. And making a whip of cords, he drove them all out of the temple with the sheep and oxen. And he poured out the coins of the money changers and overturned their tables. And he told those who sold the pigeons, take these things away. Do not make my Father's house a house of trade. Jesus was setting God's house in order. The religious leaders of the day had discovered that the temple could be a great source of revenue. Not just for the temple and to keep the temple functioning, but for their own pockets. And so they allowed the merchants to set up in the temple, into the house of the Lord, and sell cattle, and sell sheep, and sell doves at overpriced to the people who came to the temple to offer sacrifices for whatever reason. The money changers would exchange their foreign money for temple money, which was all that could be used in order to pay the temple tax and other fees of the temple, and they would exchange the money at an unfair rate. And of course, all this was done because the religious authorities got a cut of the profits that the merchants made. And so Jesus makes it a priority to put God's house in order. We have seen the same problem in the history of the church. We have seen where religious authorities have at times taken the church from its truth and used it for personal gain. We all know the history of the Middle Ages, when you had the Medici family in Italy that became so powerful they began to buy the papacy. And they would have relatives that would pay. Relatives who had not been trained as priests, were not bishops, were not archbishops or cardinals, were not theologically trained, they would just pay. You could buy a bishop's office the same way. At the time of Luther, we had one bishop that bought two or three bishops' offices, and you were only supposed to be the bishop of one diocese. And so the church needed to be cleansed. We had to set its priorities back in order, which was not raising money, but saving souls. Not making money to build grand buildings, but to reach out with the good news of the gospel of Jesus Christ, that through faith in him, your sins are forgiven, and you have the promise of eternal life. Not by anything you do, but because it's all been done by Jesus Christ. And so just as God's house being in order was a priority of Jesus, Lent reminds us that we need to stop and take a look and examine ourselves and make sure that the priority of the church is still the priority, which is to save souls. The church is not supposed to be just another public institution where you can swim and bowl and play basketball and volleyball and baseball and do all those things you can do in a secular world. The purpose of the church is to proclaim the gospel of Jesus Christ. The churches in Africa are exploding. In talking with African pastors, I've never had one tell me that churches in Africa have gyms, or swimming pools, or bowling alleys, or even ball fields. Because the people gather there to have their souls healed. The people gather there to hear the comfort of confession and absolution. They come there to hear the word proclaimed and to participate in the sacraments so that they can face a new week in that confidence of their faith in Jesus Christ. So the priority, second priority, is to make sure that our church, whether nationally or synodically or worldwide or locally, make sure that the church's priorities are what they should be. To proclaim the good news and to serve the widow, the orphan, the stranger, and the hungry in our midst. Which then brings us to the third priority of Jesus, and that is the requirement of a right purpose. Kind of piggybacks the second one of having the house in order. The priority of a right purpose. Jesus' priority was that faith had a right purpose. The faith of the temple was not to make money, but to be where the devout Jew could come and make their sacrifices and receive comfort from the priest who then interceded for them before Almighty God, the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. That is the purpose of the church today. In St. Matthew's account of the cleansing of the temple, he tells us that after Jesus cleansed the temple, the blind and the lame came to him to be healed. And now we see the priority of the right purpose of the church. Purpose of the gospel, of the word, and the church is to bring sight to the spiritually blind and healing to the spiritual lame. The purpose of the church is not to be the proclamation of political or social agendas. It is not the purpose of the church to tell you who to vote for. It's not the purpose of the church to tell you where to eat or what to drive or what to purchase. The purpose of the church is to proclaim Jesus Christ as Lord. The purpose of the church is to give you that relief that you don't have to do anything to try to earn salvation. That you don't have to worry about failing to keep some tradition or some law or some ritual and that puts you back at the bottom of the ladder and you have to start climbing it again. The purpose of the church is to tell you it has all been done for you in Jesus Christ. Salvation by faith through grace. Because God loved the world so much. As I mentioned Wednesday night, when we talk about the purpose of the church, its priority, it's a shame that everyone knows John 3:16. Well, that's not a shame that everybody knows John 3. Everybody should know John 3:16. What's a shame is that most people don't know John 3:17, which is just as important. John 3:16 tells us, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, so that whoever believes in him should not perish but have everlasting life." It's the good news. Then verse 17 tells us, "God sent his Son into the world not to condemn the world, but that the world might be saved through him." Unfortunately today, when you ask people about the church, asking unchurched people about it, or people who belong to a different religion, too often their answer is that the church is a place that condemns people. That the church is a place that is exclusive, not inclusive. That the church is a place that's just willing to send people to hell. But when you read John 3:17, you know that Jesus came into the world not to condemn, but to save. To save all people who at his name would kneel and bow and proclaim Jesus Christ as Lord. And so the church needs to be serious about its purpose. And if the church and if individual Christians would be serious about the purpose of Jesus Christ, then a lot of the world's ills would be less severe. If we truly show love to one another, if we truly looked after the widow, the orphan, the stranger in our midst, if we continue to feed the hungry and help the less fortunate, if we made sure that our children are growing up in safe environments, then we would not have all the violence and all the hatred and all of this separatism and all the polarization. But we have to get back to the purpose of the church: to save people, to make people new in the birth, a new birth in the waters of their baptism and their confession of Jesus Christ as Lord. Lent is calling us to renew and recommit ourselves to our Lord Jesus Christ and to his teachings and to his church. Calling us to renew or recommit ourselves to the priorities of Jesus involving routine faithfulness, setting our Father's house in order, and having the right purpose. Renewing or recommitting ourselves to these priorities can bring a healthy change for the betterment of all people. Amen. The peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus. Amen. Amen.
Mercy is great.
We pray in thanksgiving for the faithful departed,
whose lives continue to bear witness to the light of Christ in which they now abide eternally. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
Merciful God, hear our cry when we call to you. Renew and uphold us with your Spirit, through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Time for our offering. This is the third Sunday of Lent, the 40 days in which we emphasize prayer, fasting, and acts of goodwill. Things we do for our neighbor, since we love our neighbor as ourselves. Pastor has pointed out to us that we should repent, believe, love our neighbors, and love God, love our neighbors as ourselves. You can see now that we're receiving the offering, as this is the third Sunday of Lent. We have had the sermon, had the prayers of intercession, and we're going to have Holy Communion. We have the beautiful flowers today. You can see them on the view here on YouTube. Flowers in the chancel stand are to the glory of God and are presented by Otto Mitterholzer in memory of his father, Rudolf Mitterholzer, by Carol Glaze in memory of Ben, Phyllis and Jerry Cochran in memory of Martha Cochran's birthday, and Mike and Debbie Cochran, and Art and Janine Denny, in memory of Mother Martha Cochran's birthday. These are the flowers, four vases of beautiful flowers today at our altar. This is all to the glory of God. Today we have a youth event. The youth are going to scene 75 after the last service. We invite any youth who are watching this to come join our youth group here, as we have events once a month. Usually the first Sunday in each month, as members, the youth members, will be going in the afternoon after the 10:30 service, and will be chaperoned and brought to the youth events. Today it's scene 75. We invite you to come worship anytime, St. John's Lutheran Church, Springfield, Ohio, and you can participate in finding the means of eternal life, as Pastor pointed out, that these are the priorities of the church and the priorities of Jesus, that we follow the worship of God, we love God, and we make his church, as Jesus cleansed the temple, we keep the church going, we proclaim the gospel of Christ.
St. John practices an open communion for all those who are baptized and believe in Jesus Christ as a personal Lord and Savior, who believe his body and blood are truly present as he gathered his table, and are of communion age in their own individual congregation, invited and encouraged to come forward with us this day as we gather at the table of our Lord. We continue our celebration with a great thanksgiving on page 6 in your book. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
Call your people to cleanse our hearts and prepare with joy for the Paschal feast, that renewed with the gift of baptism, we may come to the fullness of your grace. And so with all the choirs of angels, with the church on earth and host of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn.
Holy, holy, holy.
from the beginning and the end, the giver of life. Blessed are you for the birth of creation. Blessed are you in the darkness and in the light. Blessed are you for your promise to your people. Blessed are you in the prophet's hopes and dreams. Blessed are you for Mary's openness to your will. Blessed are you for your son, Jesus, the wormling flesh. And the night which he was betrayed, O Lord Jesus, took bread and gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me. Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, this cup is a new covenant, my blood shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me. Let us proclaim the mystery of faith.
Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again.
With this bread and cup, we remember your word dwelling among us full of grace and truth. We remember our new birth and his death and resurrection. We look with hope for his coming.
Come, Lord Jesus.
Holy God, we long for your spirit. Come among us. Bless this meal. May your word take flesh in us. Awaken your people. Fill us with your life. Bring the gift of peace on earth.
Come, Holy Spirit.
All praise and glory are yours, the Holy One of Israel, Word of God incarnate, power of the Most High, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Gathered into one by the Holy Spirit, let us pray as Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name.
Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven.
Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Come to the banquet, for all is now.
Thank you.
forever in the risen life of Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen. Almighty God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, bless you now and forever.
Amen.
We conclude our celebration with Come Holy Spirit, which is inserted in your bulletin. Come Holy Spirit, inserted in your bulletin.
This song was written by Gloria Gaither, a member of the Gaither Trio. William J. Gaither wrote the music, and Gloria Gaither wrote the words. Come Holy Spirit. These people are still alive today. They are performing and singing songs such as Come Holy Spirit, as we understand that the Holy Spirit is with us today in the form of Jesus' body and blood, which we received in Holy Communion. This is the third Sunday of Lent. Sing with us, Come Holy Spirit, written by Gloria Gaither, the words, and the music by William Gaither, Bill Gaither Trio. Service on YouTube. This is St. John's Lutheran Church, Springfield, Ohio, at the corner of Wittenberg and Columbia. You can see the resurrected body of Jesus and the cross on their screen. And below that, statues of Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, who brought the gospel to us, brought, as they wrote, all the words of the Passion. Jesus went through. Holy Week, we'll be celebrating that right before Easter. We're now in the fourth Sunday, the third Sunday of Lent. This is the 4th of March, 2017. March 4th, 2018. We're celebrating Lent 2018. And we invite you to come worship with us at any time. St. John's Lutheran Church on the corner of Wittenberg and Columbia. We receive Holy Communion and we receive the blessing. Post-communion prayer is, God of abundance, with this bread of life and cup of salvation, you have united us with Christ. When we receive communion, we are united in the body of Christ with all the baptized believers in the world, even those who have received virtual baptism, all the believers in Christ. You have united us with Christ, making us one with all your people. So send us forth in the power of your Spirit, we may proclaim your redeeming love to the world. Continue forever in the risen life of Jesus Christ our Lord. As we repent here, we confess our sins, we profess our belief in Christ, we repent, we believe, we love God, we love one another, we go out to serve God, just as Pastor has said at the end of the service, go out and serve God. And we repent, we believe, we proclaim the gospel. That's the purpose of the church, to proclaim the gospel. And we are doing that. We invite you to come and worship and follow the example of Jesus, who worshiped in the temple, who was observed the Passover, and that we are continuing all these things that God wanted us to do. We've received a blessing here in Holy Communion, reunited with Christ, and we're promised the gift of eternal life. Who can turn down this gift of eternal life? Come here and receive the gift of eternal life through Jesus' death, who died for our sins on the cross to save us from sins. He died on the cross. And who can deny this and not receive it, as Jesus has suffered for our behalf? Jesus was God, and the Word was God, and the Word was God. The Word was with God. And this is in the beginning of the Gospel of John, that Jesus and Father are one. We believe this, we confess this, we invite you to receive Holy Communion, the blessing for your life. Jesus will be with you, and that he will also give you the gift of eternal life. We give this in behalf of other people, in behalf of others. We want them to receive eternal life. We receive communion on behalf of others. Love God and love your neighbor. Amen. We invite you to come to St. John's at any time.